Can people in the back hear me? Okay, good. So dear recipients of honorary doctorate degrees, those receiving doctoral degrees, president of Aalto University, alumni, and members of the Aalto University family. This is the third Aalto Research Day, and the intention of these events is to present and discuss and celebrate the research done by our faculty and the students here from all of Aalto's six schools. This year, the Research Day is organized as part of our ceremonial conferment of doctoral degree ceremony, and the theme is on the societal impact of research. Therefore, the special guests are honorees of the 2014 ceremonial conferment of doctoral degrees, recipients of doctoral degrees, and honorary doctorates. So during this afternoon, we have three highlights in our program. First, we have the honor of presenting the Alumnus of the Year Award for 2014 from the School of Science, and this will be handled by Dean of Science, Risto Nieminen. After that, we will have a panel discussion, which includes the value of doctoral education and its impact on society, and this will be, participants will be our four of our honorary doctoral degree recipients, plus President Tuula, Teeri, plus one Promovenda. And then downstairs, we have a chance to enjoy coffee and refreshments, and there are 25 different stands which have been prepared by our doctoral students and faculty, just highlighting some of the research which is going on at Aalto University. So with these opening remarks, I would like to welcome Provost Ilkka Niemelä to come and give some opening words for this event.
So, dear honorary guests, dear Aalto colleagues, alumni and friends. On behalf of the university, I'm very happy to welcome you all to the Aalto University Research Day 2014. We have a very interesting program ahead of us, and I'm very happy to see and welcome some of our honorary guests for the big promotion tomorrow to attend this event, and so really a privilege that some of you are even participating in the panel discussion. And I'd also like to extend my warmest thanks to the organizing school, the School of Engineering, Dean Gary Marquis and his team for their extensive efforts to make this day happen. So how does Aalto research work today? In a couple of weeks, the Academy of Finland will release its report on the status of Finnish research. The report looks actually data from 2000 to 2012 and gives an analysis on the basis of that. It is of course very important to have these kinds of analyses where Finnish research is compared to the international level. From the pre-material that we have seen, it looks that Finnish research science is losing ground and our competitors are progressing much faster than the Finnish system. Also for Aalto, this kind of a historic view is very important to understand where we were, say, 5 to 8 years ago. However, it tells relatively little of the current situation, and in particular for the future. And I just like to use a little bit of time to look at what we have done and where we are looking the situation now. So many of you who here know that since Aalto started, we have undergone significant reforms. For example, when we started in 2010, we changed our career system for professors to the internationally known tenure track system, and actually have recruited more than 190 new professors in that system. So interestingly, we are now just after 4 years of recruitment in a situation where we actually have more professors in the new tenure track system than we had from the previous system. There are a couple of reasons for that. One is that for the fast change in the career system is the rapid pace of retirement that we have at the Aalto. And this retirement actually continues quite fast also for the next few years. Another big change is the fast internationalization of the academic personnel. 30% of our new faculty in the tenure track system are international, and the overall international personnel, share of international personnel among the entire academic staff has risen quite rapidly from figures under 20% to 30% in a few years. So these are big changes. So when I look our research results and our recent progress, I feel very proud of the work that people at Aalto, so you, have done. We have made excellent improvement on every front. The number of publications, in particular in the high quality publication channels, has increased in every sector. Just one example is that in the ranking of universities for publications in the Nature family of journals, we have actually, from the data last year, we are the only university in Finland among top 200 in number 144 in the world, which is very interesting because this is just a fraction of what we do at Aalto area-wise. Our doctoral education has become more effective, and last year close to 230 doctors graduated from Aalto. This is nicely above the target levels that we set a few years ago, and well beyond, above the level that we reached a few years ago of 170-180 degrees yearly. All the researchers have become very competitive in securing highly competitive research funding. I'm particularly happy for the sharp increase in the ERC grants awarded to our top researchers. According to a recent study based on a number up till last year, we are number 59 in Europe for ERC grants, although we are a very specific university with few disciplines actually present. Other researchers have also been very active in the more applied and innovation-driven research, which is very important for our role in the society for renewing Finnish industry, gaining competitive edges, and securing new jobs, generating new jobs. Just as an example, TEKES introduced a new funding instrument for this kind of a research, these large strategic openings. TEKES, last year, TEKES has awarded 8 of these large projects, and in six of them, Aalto researchers are in leading roles. Very important fact is also that we are generating quite a lot of startups from our research. And big part of this success is due to the startup activities in and around Aalto, which are mostly driven by Aalto students, Aalto Entrepreneurship Society, and Startup Sauna. Of course, university supports this with its own measures, but I think that the role of our students have been very crucial. And this activity is actually receiving huge global interest. And as an evidence of this, you will see that in November with the Slush conference, where the expected number of participants is approaching 10,000 already this year. So huge international interest. All this tells me that we have a very bright future ahead of us if we work passionate and hard. And what is very nice also that our success is gaining also international visibility. We were extremely happy and proud that MIT ranked Aalto among one of the 5 emerging world leaders in university-based entrepreneurship innovation ecosystems in their recent study of 200 leading universities that was released a few months ago. So, with these words, once again, warmly welcome to the Aalto Research Day 2014. I hope you get inspired, meet a lot of old and in particular new colleagues, and get interesting contacts. Thank you.
Now I have the privilege of welcoming Dean of Science, Ilkka, Risto, Nieminen to come and present the Alumnus of the Year 2014 award.
Dear friends, I will start by reading the criteria for the Aalto School of Science Alumnus of the Year. The award is granted for pioneering or exceptional work, social impact or efforts to increase the visibility of the School of Science. Moreover, the individual chosen as Alumnus of the Year is hoped to act in the role of promoting interaction between his or her own field and the School of Science and Aalto University as a whole. In 2014, special emphasis will be placed on entrepreneurship. And now, I'm very happy to introduce to you the 2014 School of Science Alumnus of the Year, Managing Director Rob Blauherz, Doctor of Science in Technology. Let me give a brief description of Rob, and then I'll leave the floor to him. Rob Blauherz received his Master of Science degree in the University of Leiden in the Netherlands in 1997. He became interested in low temperature research and engineering in the famous Kamerling-Onnes laboratory. For his PhD research, Rob moved to the low temperature laboratory of the then Helsinki University of Technology and obtained his PhD under the supervision of Professor Matti Crucius. He finished his dissertation on the quantum system superfluid helium-free and its topologically stable defect in 2002. He then worked as a postdoctoral researcher back home in the Kamerling-Onnes laboratory in the Netherlands until 2004, when he moved back to Otaniemi. Here he studied the development of a low temperature refrigeration using a mechanical cryocooler for pre-cooling the apparatus, instead of the traditional liquid helium 4 bath at 4 Kelvin temperature. The first cryostat of this kind started running in the lab in 2007. His colleagues tell me that Rob has the gift of producing simple and practical designs, always relying on the most advanced technology solutions. For this reason, his cryocooler-based refrigerator was an instant success. Several requests were received for more devices. Rob decided to start commercial deliveries. Together with his longtime study friend Peter Forselman, he established the Blue Force Cryogenics Company in 2008, where he is nowadays the managing director. The main product of this company is a refrigerator with three important features: a fully automated computer-controlled operation, no cryogenic liquids are needed, and a self-contained, ready-to-use delivery of apparatus. Nowadays, the company has 25 employees and 30% worldwide market share in the sale of refrigerated systems to research establishments and universities. Thanks to the impressive feat of doubling its annual turnover from the previous year, Blue Force made it to the Technologia Kasvaja 2014 Technology Developers List. Recently, the Blue Force machine was prominently displayed in a full-page photograph in the Time magazine in a story for general public about the promising future of quantum computing and its cooling requirements. Rob has maintained a strong connection with Aalto University and has employed several of the university's researchers in product development positions. Having turned a great research innovation into a successful company, Rob is an excellent choice for the School of Science Alumnus of the Year 2014.
Microphone on? Or yes, good. So, dear Dean, President, faculty members, students, researchers, old colleagues, and of course, today's special guests, the recently graduated doctors. I believe you did all the hard work of the past years, and this day, Research Day, is mostly an honor of you. So first, I would like to start with a big congratulations to all of you. Let me start by saying how honored I am to receive this award today. When I received a telephone call from Dean Risto Nieminen a few months ago, asking if I would be willing to accept this award, I could have really not believed it at first. I mean, I believe the output of my scientific research has been more than decent, but my scientific career has just not been that long. Furthermore, it would be completely misplaced not to acknowledge that there are many people from this university that made much greater contributions to science than I have. But talking more, it then became apparent to me that this year's award special emphasis would be placed on entrepreneurship, which somewhat clarified the situation. So since most of you don't know me, let me tell a little bit about my history with Aalto University. I came to Finland for the first time in 1996 to later work on my PhD degree in a group of Professor Matti Crucius in the low temperature laboratory. Our task at that time was to study rotating superfluids at ultra low temperatures. As you can perhaps imagine, there is no equipment you can buy from a shop to perform these kind of measurements and experiments. And basically, we had to build everything ourselves. This is where I learned the important skills that require to build ultra-low temperature systems. This has been the first and very important contribution of Aalto University to my career path. After finishing my PhD degree in 2002, I moved back to the Netherlands for a short while, but then I was missing the Finnish sauna too much, and I returned in 2004 on a short-term contract for an EU project. And this was the time there appeared this first type of cryocoolers, Risto mentioned, on the market that were powerful enough so they could replace cryofluids, like liquid helium and liquid nitrogen. Historically, the necessity of these cryoliquids to reach ultra-low temperatures made the field very inaccessible. One requires special lab infrastructure. It makes automation very difficult or almost impossible. So the systems were really not easy to use, and a fair amount of your research time was always invested in keeping your fridge alive. Systems combining these new cryocoolers with an ultra-low temperature stage could change all of that, but they were not commercially available at the time. I discussed the possibility of developing such a system with Professor Petty Hakon, and also from the low temperature lab, and he was very much interested. He then provided the funding to develop and build such a system for his laboratory. This was obviously the second very important contribution of the university, providing the infrastructure, tools, and financial means to develop this new idea. At this stage, it was really just all about building something fundamentally new, and there was no discussion about starting a company or whatsoever. In fact, I was still convinced that I was going to be a researcher the rest of my life. The Low Temperature Laboratory is an internationally very well recognized laboratory, and it receives many visitors. During the next 2 years or so, when we were developing the new system, there was a lot of interest from these visitors in these new systems. Many of them actually were asking if they could purchase such a system. And this was the first time when I started to think that, okay, maybe we could actually start and try make a company out of this idea. But of course, I was very naive. As a physicist, I just did some small estimations and calculations to check if we could actually get a living out of this. I figured yes, but did not quite know how to get started. I proposed the idea to a former study friend from the Netherlands, Peter Vosselman, who Risto already mentioned, who is a fine mechanic and also has a master's degree in physics. I tried to convince him to move to Finland and build the first commercial systems together with him. At this point, my wife jumped in and told me, or better us, that we really should not start this whole thing without having a proper business plan in place. To be quite honest, I really didn't know at that time what that implemented. In fact, at that time, I knew so little about running a business that I most likely couldn't tell you the difference between a balance sheet or a profit and loss report. Luckily, we were made aware of the Venture Cup, a three-stage business plan competition. And regardless of winning it, by joining the competition, a group of professionals would validate your ideas, look if it all makes sense, and if it did, you would advance to the next round. The competition was structured in such a way that if you made it all the way to the final round, you would end up having a full business plan. We joined the season in 2007-2008 and got an overall third place. This was a verification that our idea actually made sense, and of course a very good motivation. I believe nowadays the Venture Cup competition no longer exists. Therefore, having people at the university, as was just explained, that can help scientists writing and validating a business plan is very beneficial and important. Another crucial point at the time was the transfer of IP rights from the university to the company that we are about to start. I don't know really what's the current policy of the university, but at the time, we could obtain them at quite moderate cost, perhaps because in our case also there were no patents involved. If the university wants to promote entrepreneurship, I believe they also should keep the IP transfer requirements very modest. I believe eventually the investment will come back to the state and university via tax money paid. We personally decided to go a route without investors. And every euro we spent in the first years was turned over many times and spent several times. And I think if there would have been significant payments to be made, we simply wouldn't have survived in the beginning. Our company then was finally established in 2008 as a two-man spin-off company from the university. And according to the first business plan, the first systems were completely hand-built by Peter and me. With our business plan, we were even able to borrow a small amount of money from the bank. Since the start, our company has then been steadily growing and about doubled in size every year. Especially in the first years, it has proven extremely valuable that many of the researchers of the Low Temperature Lab have been very positive and mentioned our company and products to their colleagues, for example, when they went to conferences and workshops. Besides our own contribution, being able to make the systems reliable and easy to use, we were quite fortunate about the developments in the market. The prices of liquid helium have been skyrocketing, pushing all researchers towards our type of systems. Also, our original estimate of the market was far too small. First of all, the new easy-to-use systems opened the market to research areas that in the past would never even have thought they would go into low temperatures. Secondly, and maybe more important, the field of quantum computing is rapidly expanding, and they need the ultra-low temperatures to run their processors. So besides universities and research institutes, there is now a commercial available application, and actually those make up quite a significant part of our sales nowadays. Many people have come to me and asked if I can explain the reason for our success and how to generate more successful companies in Finland. To be quite honest, I don't think there is something like a mathematical formula or a well-defined recipe. The start of any successful company, I think, is having a new idea, either for improving existing technology or process or for an entirely new product. Where the university can help is creating a breeding ground for such ideas by investing in basic research and creating independent thinkers. Here I would like to mention that I took the phrase creating independent thinkers from the former head of the low temperature laboratory, Professor Mikko Palanen, who was the head at the time I was working there. Actually, it was his definition of what is the lab responsibility, creating independent thinkers. He has also been one of the persons that has been very supportive in the process of starting our company. Let's hope not, but maybe creating independent thinkers may become more and more a challenge. The more predefined the degree program is getting in order to make it more effective, should not stop that. Also, I believe the focus should not be just on high growth companies. If one sets the standard too high, it will kill a lot of creativity. It will basically just prevent people from starting altogether. In our original business plan, we did not focus on high growth at all. In my opinion, there is nothing wrong in having a small and stable, as long as it is a profitable company. With the expectations being so high, it sometimes felt that small-sized but profitable companies are no longer called a success. And I think it's quite the opposite. I truly believe it makes more sense to concentrate on volume, creating a large number of small spin-offs. Maybe not that interesting to investors, but it will create a vibrant scene for startups. And I believe it will also not be bad at all for the economy. In any case, if the idea is good and the market is there, these startups will naturally develop in fast growth companies anyway, as happened to us. For me personally, the university has played an important role in almost every aspect of starting our company. And I really hope it will be able to do so for the new generation of spin-offs as well. I also believe in the future the university will play an important role to our company. We are still growing, full of new ideas, and therefore we will be in need of new researchers. And hopefully we can attract some of the new graduates from this university. Last but not least, I hope it was clear from this speech, it has not been a one-man show to get here in front of you today. I owe a lot to the university, my old colleagues, my friends, and of course my family, especially my wife. Many thanks to all of you. I wish to conclude by thanking you all again for this award. It is a true honor.
Invite our six panelists to come in. The seating is free. He's previously held positions as the president and CEO of several major and listed companies. Presently, he acts as the chairman and the board of directors of several companies. During his career, he has acted in several positions of trust in student and other societal organizations. He is currently the chairman of the board of the Finnish Foundation for Technology Promotion. Mr. Jorma Eloranta is a member of the advisory board, or was a member of the advisory board for Helsinki University of Technology during the years 2001 through 2006. and was the chairman of that board during the years 2007 through 2009. He has significantly contributed to the fundraising of both Helsinki University of Technology and the Aalto University Foundation. Our next honorary doctor is Professor Mikko Hupa, who is the Vice Rector of Åbo Academi University and is a professor at the Department of Chemical Engineering and the Director of the Laboratory of Inorganic Chemistry. In his research, Professor Hupa has specialized in high temperature processes and materials, especially combustion processes and ceramic materials. Professor Hupa has acted as an expert in several organizations and institutions both in Finland and abroad. For instance, he has been the president of the International Flame Research Foundation. Professor Hupa is the founder and director of the Graduate School in Chemical Engineering. The next honorary doctor is Professor Torgeir Moan from the Department of Marine Structures at NTNU in Norway. Professor Moan is the director of the Center of Excellence in Ships and Ocean Structures. His main research area is in the analysis and design of marine structures with a focus on safety assessment. Professor Moan has received several research awards and has been elected as a member of the Royal Academy of Engineering in the UK. He has contributed significantly to academic accident inquiries and to developing various structural design standards for offshore and other structures. In the research assessment exercise at Aalto University in 2008, Professor Moan acted as a member of the panel of mechanical engineering and automation, and he is currently the chairman of the scientific advisory board of the Aalto University School of Engineering. Our fourth honorary doctor on the panel today is Professor H. Vincent Poor, from the Dean of Engineering and Applied Science at Princeton University in the United States. His research interests are in the areas of information and computation theory, statistical signal processing, and stochastic analysis and their applications in wireless networks and related fields. These include social networks and smart grids. Professor Poor is a member of the National Academy of Sciences in the United States, a fellow of several important scientific organizations, and he has received a number of honors and awards worldwide. Professor Poor has hosted several long-term research visits from Aalto University to Princeton University, and he has acted as a distinguished lecturer at the Helsinki University of Technology and Aalto University. The next panelist is known to all of us, President Tuula, Teeri. Is the first president of Aalto University, a role which she's held since April 1st, 2009, and now her second five-year term as president began April 1st, 2014. During her scientific career, Professor Teeri was a pioneer of forest industrial biotechnology and the development of biomimetic materials. Tuula Teeri has held research and leadership positions in different universities and research institutes. She is a member of the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences, the Royal Swedish Academy of Engineering Sciences, the Technology Academy of Finland, and the Swedish Academy of Technology in Finland. And she is co-founder of Sweetree Technologies. Our sixth panelist is Promovenda Dr. Anna Mikola, who finished her doctoral thesis on the effects of flow equalization and pre-fermentation on the biological nutrient removal at wastewater treatment plants. She earned her degree in 2013. Since then, she has been working part-time as a postdoc researcher in the Water and Environmental Engineering Research Group at Aalto University. Since 2001, she has also been working part-time for the consulting companies and now still works half-time for Rambol, which is a multidisciplinary company for engineering, design, and consultancy. So with these brief introductions, what I've done is I've asked each of the honorary doctors to make a short introductory statement. And we will simply do this in alphabetical order, And based on this, Jorma Eloranta will be our first to comment. So please.
Thank you. So professors, doctors, ladies and gentlemen, I honestly feel humble to be invited in this prominent panel. I'm the only non-doctor in this panel, and I never earned my living by research. So my background is, as was told there, that I got a master's degree in the Helsinki University of Technology. I think somebody will still in the audience remember that one. And from the Department of Industrial Engineering and Management. And thereafter, I have been a business leader. So I've been chairman of various companies and worked as a chairman of more than 36 years and a CEO more than 28 years and 18 years in two listed companies. So mainly in industrial manufacturing companies. Why I'm telling that is just putting the doctorship also into my perspective. The last position I had is a CEO position was Metso Corporation, today merged as Metso and Valmet. Back then, Metso employed 30,000 employees, a bit more, including some 8,000-9,000 university or high school engineers. And we had 150 doctors among those, and mainly in the field of technology. So at the moment, I'm in various chairing various companies, five of them. One is startups, and four companies where are listed in Helsinki Stock Exchange. And taking one example, the biggest one is the Neste Oil refining and marketing company, and so forth. Is the world leading supplier of renewable diesel. And Neste Oil have 5,000 employees, including 811 master's degree in engineering, and 65 is doctorate level degree. So if I think about from a board's perspective that to be a global market leader, more than 2 billion euro business in renewable diesel, next PTL, that was developed by those doctors and engineers. And without their contribution, the board could not have made the decision to invest 500 million euros, which was based on our strategic long-term development plan and our refineries and assets in Finland. This decision was disclosed on Tuesday, last Tuesday. So that's the perspective I'm looking also the doctoral education and the doctoral education and its impact on society. And what are the biggest challenges of our society, and how the doctoral education could impact the society. I take only two themes where the societies need action and doctors. It is the economic growth and environmental challenges. First about the economic growth, I could say that in Europe and in particular in Finland, a lack of competitiveness and a consequential modest economic growth is creating a lot of problems and difficulties for the society. We can say that the poor economic cycle, recession even, is naturally causing an impact, but I'm not so worried about that. The main concern are the many forms of structural weaknesses and causing in long-term stagnation. During the last few years, Finland has not been competitive as a country. Manufacturing share of our Finnish GDP was year 2000 over 25%. And 2007, it was something like 23%, and last year only 15%. So decrease 40% is huge. Our export was 48% compared to our GDP in 2008. And now it is about 10 percentage units lower, something like 38%. It is dramatic development there as well. So what then to do? In order to have growth, we need innovations, new ways of doing things and creating economic value. In my opinion, the business transformations, finding new inventions as well as innovations in companies analytical skills and the modern know-how of the doctors could bring a lot more value to our companies and through that to our societies. And I think also our companies have an urgent need for independent thinkers. So then about the environmental issue, I think one of the major megatrends, global megatrends, is sustainability and the effective use of resources such as energy and raw materials. People all over the world want to increase their living standard and at the same time also they are using natural resources in order to increase their economic welfare. At the same time, the aim is to find ways to use those resources with as low impact to the natural nature as possible, to strike that balance or imbalance with the divergent targets is to create new inventions and new innovative business models, new technological solutions, digitalization and industrial internet, they are one of those key words in that work. As my conclusion is that the doctors will have a bigger impact on the biggest impact on the society when they do what they know and can best. I feel that the strategic cooperation between industry and universities benefit not only the companies, definitely do that, but also the students and teachers, researchers, ultimately the whole university community. I'm a very strong advocate for industry, university, industry, school cooperation at all levels of education. So there are many reasons why public funding for education and research is unlikely to grow materially during the coming years. Also, therefore, I want to encourage doctors to consider to start their own companies, like the Alumnus of the year 2014 had an excellent example, or look what existing companies, even small and medium-sized company enterprises in Finland or elsewhere might have the most value of their know-how, and then do the active or even aggressive or shameless sales work. To continue the career as academic researcher is not the only alternative for doctors, in particular those having technology as background. My understanding is that some leaders in business community are afraid of recruiting doctors because they are afraid of their so-called narrow educational and research knowledge. Whether that is true or not, I want to encourage all doctoral students and postdocs to learn main fundamentals of business, I mean business plans and profit and loss statements, balance sheets and so forth. Actually, it's not that complicated. Just taking a CEO view, all you need to remember is that company need to have more sales than expenses or more revenues than costs with high enough margin and always cash available. And then if you take a board view, chairman's view, all you need is to have a right strategy and good CEO in place. The rest is piece of cake. at least when you know that much of the business, you are qualified to become a vuorineuvos.
Thank you very much. At least I'm motivated now to become a CEO. Our next, I'd like to ask Professor Hupa to make his opening remark.
Okay. Yes, good afternoon, everybody. I'm also very honored to be part of this interesting panel and very honored of the doctorate from Aalto. My background is I'm a professor at a chemical engineering department at Obu Academy. And I have quite a long experience of PhD training in my own work. I have supervised about 40 PhD works in my area. And the PhD workers are really the ones that do the research, the bulk of the research in our case, like in many other engineering areas. I also have had a really nice experience with a system which was mentioned here. It's a graduate school, national graduate school in chemical engineering. And that is something that we, many of you know, we have had in Finland, these national graduate schools. This one was a joint venture with Aalto, Lappeenranta, Oulu, and Obu, our group. And we had continuously 50 PhD students at that system. And so far we have graduated 120 PhDs from the school. And that is something that is quite good to see back now. This is a system which is about 20 years old, and we still continue. The PhD system in Finland is in many ways is changing, has changed already within the last 20 years. And also there is a kind of pressure to continue changing. And I can say some of my feelings now after this this experience. When I did my own PhD, it was 1980, so it's more than 30 years ago, many things looked very different. And I think that the changes I'm now going to list here are mostly very positive. Previously, when you started your PhD, you just announced your interest to the faculty and you were listed as a PhD worker, and then you started. And I think the biggest problem was that there was no proper plan required, and there was no proper plan. People just started doing their PhD and then gradually hopefully it became a PhD work. The other thing was there was no clear nomination of supporting supervisors. So when I started, I had no supervisor nominated. There were people who were slightly interested in my work, sure. But the formal confirming of a joint work, I think PhD works at their best, they are joint efforts. They are efforts by the candidate or the student and the supervisor, or maybe several supervisors. So that is another very very important thing that today is much better handled, I think, all over. The supervisor commitment is clear. And the third problem was that there was no time plan. So you just started with the work and then gradually it became a PhD, but there was no clear time plan from the beginning, and I think that has been something that we have very much stressed in our graduate school system now, in that we, from the first place, there is a plan of 4 years where the plan already contains steps that need to be done until the final manuscript of the thesis is there. And it's of course clear that it's very hard to plan PhD work because so many surprises may pop up, but the most important thing is that there is a plan, and then the plan can be modified, because this in a way structures the work much better. Teamwork, that's I think the third thing, or maybe third thing, which I think has been much better now, and is delightful to see that most of the PhD works are part of teams, research teams, project teams. So it's no longer the work of a person alone, but there are many people who are interested in that contribution, and I think that is great. That of course needs that there is a good planning of that collaboration and teamwork, so that everybody knows what is the part of their own PhD and how will it be handled. The system we have in Finland, which is very good as compared with other countries, is this, that the engineering thesis particularly are collections of journal publications. It is not so common in the world to do it that way, but I think that is something that works very well. And it also helps in the collaboration, because also postdocs or other senior researchers who participate in supporting the PhD students have a nice contribution of their own when they become co-authors of such papers. So I think that is something that many of you who may not know, that it is quite nice and unique in our system. Still today, the biggest problem probably is that the PhD works tend to take a long time. And even if we have our target of 4 years, we just, and in our graduate school where everybody's working full time, I think we are approaching that 4 years, but still I think we are in average is about 4.5. But it's of course very close already. But that is, I think our theses are the heaviest ones in Europe, in average still. And then a good question is how to improve that. To spend more than 4 years with a PhD, I don't think it's a good way of having the system in our country. Then one more thing. The number of PhDs has increased dramatically, and many people wonder where do all these PhD end up in Finland. In my own area, it's a good example. My PhD dealt with combustion chemistry, combustion engineering, and at that time, earlier 1980s, I was the second PhD in the country with that type of topic. And today I have an unofficial statistics. I think there are 40 PhDs in combustion related engineering in the country. So it's a very interesting increase in the number, and the explanation is that area, combustion engineering, has really developed into such a level of complexity and sophistication that the need for research-oriented development has become so obvious. Jorma, Eloranta mentioned here environmental challenges. That is one of the driving factors. Previously, combustion engineering was mechanical engineering, not much problems with chemical details, but now they are kind of leading problems in the areas. Materials, sophisticated materials are needed, which were not previously so important. And then fuels, the fuel quality has changed dramatically. Very poor quality biomasses, we want to use them, and of course how to treat them and how to use them is a very complex issue. I summarized by saying that most of the development that has happened in our PhD education and training have been very, very good. And I think we should continue developing it. I also think that there is a big need for PhDs in the area of engineering still. So I don't share the idea that there are too many of them. But I very much agree with Jorma Eloranta that the close connection between industrial needs, industrial companies, and the university and the PhD training is a key to help us to have the people doing relevant things so that they have a future, good future in the industry. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for this helpful perspective. Next, I would invite Professor Moan to give his views on this influence of doctors on society.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here to visit Aalto and to participate in this seminar. My background is civil, mechanical, and marine engineering, and doctoral education is very close to my heart. So I immediately accepted to be on this panel. 2 days ago, my doctoral candidate number 70 graduated successfully with his thesis. So I have put a lot of emphasis on doctoral education, and I don't think there is any limit to number of the demand for doctoral candidates if we produce candidates with good quality and relevant back basis. So that is my, we can sell this product without any problem if we ensure that the quality and the relevance is good enough. So let me then take a look back, and the history of doctoral degrees started with providing a doctoral degree as a license to teach us at university. But even then, of course, there was research involved. Today, as Professor Hupa mentions, we look at PhD education or doctoral education as much broader. It's not only research. You should acquire transferable knowledge and skills also that have some generic value so that you can use it in different types of situations, not narrowly in the research topic you perform during your doctoral work. That is crucial, I think. So coursework is an important part of it. Then we have this issue, should the work be completely independent or should it be supervised? Of course, now the PhD tradition is to have supervised doctoral studies. But still, a main issue is to become an independent researcher when you graduate with your thesis. Then your supervisor, or advisor I prefer to say, should learn more from you than you learn from him, because already then there should be some feedback. And that, I think, is my experience, that that is why it's so very interesting to work with doctoral candidates. I would like to put two things as a headline for my few remarks. One, the importance, and second, the challenges. Because as I said, we need to challenge ourselves to make the product as good as possible. Of course, the importance is for the individuals, you who do the PhD or the doctoral degree. Then it is crucial for the university to excel internationally. I mean, we have no chance to excel internationally if we don't have very good doctoral programs, in my mind. And this is because also the products of PhD education is not only the research, the papers you write. It is you as a person that go to, some of you go to academia, but most of you go other places in private and public sectors. And then you spread the information not only related to your own research work, but to other research also. So that is a very important aspect, in my opinion. But at the same time, while you are a doctoral candidate, you contribute to a very nice and good educational environment at the university. So that elevates the level of master and bachelor education also, if we do it properly. So that is crucial also, and all these benefits to the universities, of course, then makes a big impact on the society, because it is not only the publications, it's much more than that. So that is my point. Regarding challenges, I would like to start asking also, what is the demand for PhD or doctoral candidates today? Well, as I already said, if we provide candidates with excellent quality and relevance, there is no problem. I mean, we experience in Norway that small companies start to, without innovation, but they employ doctoral candidates because they feel to be competitive. They need to have somebody who has learned how to go deeply into things and explore new things, because there are more and more challenges and complex systems to deal with. So relatively small companies, they employ quite a lot of doctoral candidates. So relatively small percentage end up in academia and in research institutes. We have some big, like you in Finland, VTT and so on. We have SINTEF in Norway. We have the TNO in the Netherlands and Fraunhofer in Germany. They employ PhD candidates, but the industry itself employ very many. But we need to be in front and in the research. I agree fully that in engineering we need to keep in close contact with industry, but I would usually say I would like to keep in close contact with visionary industry that look for not only for what they should have done yesterday, but what they would be going for in the future, and then try to formulate research tasks that go for the future, because also universities has their own interest in looking to be in the forefront, because if we do what the industry is doing right now, we are not competitive with the industry itself. They have a big staff, they have resources, and they can do everything. So we need to be in the forefront, we need to do new things, and then we come in a position where we get funding for research and so on, because we become very attractive. And I fully agree with you regarding teamwork and so on. If you look at how you do it in big companies where they have research departments, they form teams, you learn from each other. So if we don't do that in universities, why should we award doctoral degrees? Why shouldn't companies or research institutes award doctoral degrees? If you look at worldwide activities, there are institutions that, other than universities, that can award doctoral degrees. So that is something. The main point, we should maintain very high quality and relevance, and then we are really competitive. And finally, innovation, of course, is on the agenda for everyone. I see a problem, usually, when a doctoral candidate does his research, because on one hand, he needs to do basic research, produce journal papers, etc. Then if we start to think about commercialization of some good ideas, then he would be totally distracted from finishing his research. So that is a challenge we need to try to resolve in a proper manner. We have so far in my university decided at least to start to award postdocs for innovation, because you have identified ideas that should be pursued for commercialization. But on the other hand, universities are also measured on the quality, and then publications and these kind of things matter, right? So we have a conflict there. So we need to find some good way to do that, because it's absolutely necessary that we contribute to innovation. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Moan. I think you communicated very clearly that passion is part of it as well, even without saying the word, it was obvious. We'll go on to Professor Poore, if you would like to make your opening remark.
Yes. Well, first of all, thank you, Dean Marquis, for organizing this panel, and I'm very happy to be a part of it. And like my fellow panelists, I feel very honored to be participating today. Well, first of all, I think many excellent points have already been made, and some of the things I might have said have already been said. So I'll try to be brief, and I'll just make some general comments that I think complement some of the things that have been said already. First of all, you know, at a very fundamental level, there have to be members of society who pursue unbiased and thorough scholarly inquiry into important issues that we face as society. And the research doctorate is the training for that kind of pursuit. So it's a very basic and important part of society. Doctoral education is the vehicle by which the most sophisticated and cutting-edge methods of research are passed along to those who fill this role in modern society. In my field of electrical engineering, important contributions come from people with many different educational backgrounds, not only those with doctorates. But I think it's safe to say that some of the most society-altering technological advances of the modern era have originated from the research of those with doctoral degrees. Examples include the transistor, the integrated circuit, the computer, the internet, and so on. This is a very long list, and I think the same story is repeated in many fields, scientific, engineering, and other fields. So because of the impact of doctoral education, we live lives that are much better connected, much better informed, much healthier, and much more productive than we would otherwise lead. Of course, and we're talking here mainly about technological education, but beyond that, doctoral education also leads to a greater understanding of human behavior and the human condition more generally, and also can greatly improve the quality of our lives and of our social interactions. Now, of course, not all consequences of technological and other advances are uniformly positive, but on balance, they greatly improve the quality of life, our lives. So frankly, I wouldn't relish living in a society without the contributions of the research community, which is in today's world is overwhelmingly identified with a community of scholars educated through doctoral programs. So I think I'll stop there, but I look forward to further discussion through the question and answer period. So thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I didn't ask actually our other panelists to make to prepare a statement in advance, so I just have a brief question, and I will start with just a question for President Teeri. So at Aalto University, we've devoted significant attention to our doctoral education. As president, how do you view the future impact of Aalto's doctors on society?
Yes, thank you very much for this question. And also, I was listening to my fellow panelists, and I said that, you know, there is not much to add to what you have already said, you know, because I think that, you know, it will be difficult for us to come up with a debate because we all seem to agree very much on the basic principles about this. I say doctoral education with relevance, you know, relevance being, of course, a little bit difficult term to define, because of course all knowledge generation creates relevance in some time scale or other. But what I mean is that, you know, if you think of the Aalto University mission, you know, we have a special national mission actually to work for the benefit of Finland and maybe more specifically to help broaden the industrial base of Finland, which we have then given the task of doing by research excellence. Multidisciplinary interaction, which of course broadly taken also of course includes in our areas of expertise very much good contacts with the industries. And so I think that, you know, the basis for all doctoral education has been really well described here, that, you know, you need to kind of engage in kind of activities that are generating new knowledge into the society, the new knowledge being based on scientific research, which means that it's factual. And of course, you know, now with the digital society, there's all kinds of information available, you know, but only part of that information is based on scientific research, and therefore we can trust that there is some kind of a experimentation or careful analysis of this information, that it actually is true. The other thing that I think is very important in our kind of education, actually at all different levels, is that, you know, it's not just to produce the facts, but it's also to sort of turn this knowledge into a problem-solving capacity. And this, of course, you know, for all of the different kinds of disciplines, engineering, of course, in particular, but also in the design and business development, you need to be able to help society evolve, and that oftentimes ends up in some sort of a problem-solving mission. So I think also very much that, you know, we should very carefully think about, and we are doing it. You know, we have a new policy for doctoral education as of last year, where we kind of see that, you know, we should very sort of articulate quite clearly, you know, the goals of our doctoral education, not only in knowledge generation, even though it is of course a very important part of it, but also to see that, you know, we are giving capacities to our students, you know, or allow them to, or encourage them to get capacities also to work in other kinds of jobs than not just in the academia. And it's clear that I don't think we have quite many universities in Finland, but I think not quite enough to employ all of the doctoral students that we're educating. So I think it should be considered a valuable contribution also to find a job after dissertation, you know, in other positions in the world. And in the society. I think you know, when we talk about excellence, I think that that's a very important competence, and it was very clearly here already articulated that of course, you know, the research quality needs to be very high if we are going to produce genuinely new ideas and solutions to challenges. And I think that also increasingly these days, if you look at the challenges that are facing us, they're getting more and more complex, and therefore they will be needing interactions, you know, not only between, not only deep knowledge in one particular discipline, but also the capacity to be able to cross the borders, you know, and look at other disciplines, and also maybe this, like we have discussed that, you know, the vertical collaboration, you know, between university, research institutes, also industries. There's knowledge in all of these places, it's just a little bit different angle to the knowledge in different actors, and I think we really need to take this collaborative challenge seriously. So I think that, you know, the basic and applied approaches and work and research, they should work in dialogue. And I think that, you know, when you talk about how does that then turn into innovation, you know, we say that, you know, Aalto-University is where science and art meet technology and business. And I think I'd like to say that, you know, innovation is born when an idea meets a problem. And that, of course, means for our doctoral students and our researchers that, you know, we have to have this sort of broad understanding of the problems that are facing us in the future, so that when we then come up with an idea, we know where we can offer a solution. The other side being that, you know, when we do really innovative, excellent research, you know, it also creates new opportunities. So sometimes there is no problem, but there occurs a huge opportunity, which also we have to be able to disseminate and translate into some sort of an action in the society. So I think that, you know, grave challenges, you know, these are the kind of ambitions I think our doctoral programs, and I think we have grave challenges. If you just read the newspaper any morning these days, you know, you will see that there will be lots of problems to solve and all kinds of skills are going to be needed. So I think that we do need even more doctors than we are educating today, but it's very, very important that they have this capacity to work also in other environments than just universities. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Tuula. And our final panelists, I would just ask Dr. Mikola, you are, tomorrow receiving your doctoral hat, so congratulations on that accomplishment. You have a unique position that you work 50% now as a postdoc at the university and also 50% at a consulting company. How do you view the results of your own research work being used in your kind of industrial contexts?
Well, actually, I think that the research or the results from my project were actually applied surprisingly fast, and so the whole idea of my research project was to operate wastewater treatment plants in such a way that you could save energy and also decrease the chemicals that you need to add there to get rid of some of the pollutants. And I was really motivated by the fact that actually already at 2009, this way of operating the process was applied in Turku, Kakolamäki treatment plant. So it was 4 years before I even finished my doctoral thesis. And after that, I have definitely been able to use the knowledge in several assignments. So that has been a very practical doctoral thesis project in that sense. And in general, I think that I'm actually maybe a bit surprised to hear, or I have also heard the comments that doctors have too theoretical or too narrow understanding of things, but my personal experience has been that most or the majority of the assignments that of my projects in consulting field are very close to the project or my thesis work. So it's a kind of all the environmental assessments, the complex problems in when you want to treat different waste are very close to what I actually at least did in doing my doctoral thesis. So I agree with all the panelists that I definitely don't see any limit of how we could use the understanding and knowledge that we can learn from a doctoral study.
Okay, thank you very much, Anne. I think the majority in our audience are actually some of our own doctoral students here at Aalto University, and maybe I would like this chance to open up to any questions from the audience, if anyone is bold enough. Right.
Actually, welcome and good afternoon. I want to ask a question from Professor Moan. I want to know that actually today there is a discussion about the role of the fundamental research and the applied research in the engineering sciences. How do you view on this discussion about the role of the fundamental researches and the role of the applied researches for the doctoral students? Because you worked on the, for example, I think more in the industry and the safety of the sheep, and I want to know that, what do you think about this discussion? Thank you.
To give an example how we formulate our strategy for research, I've been running a center, research center in the university, and when we started out, we discussed with visionary industry, and we tried to challenge ourselves to try to see what kind of structures or systems would be relevant 20 years from now. What are the trends? Could we see something? And then we define. Then you look back to the disciplines, actually, because we have several disciplines and we would like to promote the development in each of the disciplines, because that represents preparedness for future, solving future problems. So then we define how we should go about to improve the knowledge within each of the disciplines which were represented in the center. And then we formulated basic research stocks. But then, a couple of years later, it turned out that the industry was immediately catching some of the results we got, even if we would like to look with a much longer time perspective and so on. But it's very hard, of course, to say what is basic research, what is applied, and what is engineering for that matter. What we should try to at least focus on in universities is research, generate new knowledge. Not doing close to engineering, because that does the industry much better than universities in a way. So, that are my comments, I think, for now.
Do any of the other panelists want to comment on basic and
so? Yeah, I would like to say thank you for the question. It comes often that people would like to classify our work on basic and applied, and I think it's a very unlucky way of looking at what we're doing, because engineering, particularly in engineering part, everything has some idea, whatever we do, there is some idea of how that would be useful or beneficial. So from a very from that point of view, we could call all of our research applied if we like. On the other hand, if we do things with a very sophisticated equipment and have a far-sighted objective, then some people would call it basic. It doesn't help much, and the problem with these two terms are that when you bring them to political level, then people are very strict and they very heavily see a big difference and want to see things divided that way. And it's often very unlucky. So one of my colleagues said that we shouldn't talk at law. I like this idea that we shouldn't talk about basic and applied research. We should talk about good research and poor research.
Okay, all right. Do any other panelists want to comment on that? Okay, question second row. Wait for the microphone. Could you bring the microphone here? Portale.
Hello. Thank you for the panelists for excellent small speeches. I'm coming from the School of Arts, so I'm representing here the multidisciplinary of the Aalto University, and this is I've been working myself in a neurocinematic project combining neurosciences and arts and cinema. So I would like to ask you, because one of the tasks of the university is also to, of course, the word well-being has been expressed here several times, but I would like to ask any of the panelists who would like to comment on how you see, in addition to combining hard sciences and facts and economical growth, with also with the design and art and humanist aspects, philosophical aspects of being in the world in general. So I hope that these are not in any conflict in your replies. Thank you.
So which of our panelists would like to, Professor Poor?
Yeah, I'll say a few words about that. I mean, you know, Princeton University, my institution, is basically a liberal arts institution. So, you know, we at Princeton, even though I'm an engineering school, We think very much about our interaction with the humanities and the creative arts and so forth. And also my daughter, by the way, is a doctoral student in art history, so I have a very personal interest in this. And I think, you know, engineering in particular is a creative field, and I think it has a lot to say to the arts and vice versa. The arts, of course, also being a creative field largely. And at Princeton, we have a lot of interactions between engineering and the arts, you know, dance and visual arts, music, and so forth. And we find that there's the barriers between these two fields are quite low. And we also find that we learn quite a bit about how to think creatively about things like design. Which is, of course, a broad field, not encompassing not only engineering, but also, you know, the human elements, as you say. So I personally feel like there should not be, like there shouldn't really be a distinction between applied and theoretical or applied and fundamental research. I think we should be careful not to draw distinctions between, such sharp distinctions between fields like art and say technology or science, which are actually in some ways very closely connected. So I think there's a lot to be said for greater connections there.
I think President Teeri would like to make a comment as well.
Well, just to say, I was once in another panel, you know, discussing about the art and science, kind of, you know, comparing their importance in the society, and I think it was Irina Kroon who was saying that, you know, that when you talk about understanding, not just knowledge, but understanding, you know, there's in her mind two different ways toward understanding, and one is data and information, and the other, and which you can get with research and science, and the other one is experience, you know. So I think that, you know, when you combine the two, you know, then we will come to a comprehensive understanding of things, you know. So I think definitely art has a very, very important role in increasing the understanding of all these different issues. When I look at what has happened in Aalto, you know, I can see I mean, you know, we all have our sort of views of what design, for instance, is, you know, but what has been, there's been two things that has surprised me, you know, and which I'm actually really, have been really pleased to be surprised, you know, is that how the designers have the capability of adding the human angle to different kinds of solutions that we offer, you know, whether they are technical or business solutions or whatever. And I think that, you know, the other thing is that, you know, somehow, you know, the artistic training seems to give people a very holistic understanding, you know, how things relate to each other, you know. So I think that, you know, there's definitely sort of complementarity in the artistic and scientific, you know, educations, which I think that, you know, will greatly benefit Finland and Europe, you know, once we get our act together completely. But the first signs of this collaboration I've seen, they're very encouraging. And finally, just a very short comment, you know, I said some kind of an engineering journal, you know, just last week actually, where one of the titles, and I didn't have time to read the actual article, but it was the urgency of teaching art to engineers.
Okay, thank you. I think Jorma had one comment.
Just one practical application on that issue, namely, I mentioned that at Metso we had some 8,000-9,000 engineers, but we had 12 full-time employees on design. And the reason was to mix those people in, because the designers had the brains a little bit different way than the engineers. And they were thinking the same problem, same issues differently. And that makes the value of better products. It's not only the beauty of the product, it is much else also the how to use it and so. And their way of thinking was different, and that makes the really value of the developing new products.
Okay, I think there was a comment on that side there, please. Wait for the microphone. You're all being taped here. So.
And thank you. My name is Arsha Said. I'm doing a PhD in School of Engineering, Department of Energy to Technology. I have a question to Professor Hupa. And as you mentioned in your introductory, also you have supervised a lot of PhD students. So if you make some assessment, what are the most important skills that a PhD student can learn during his or her PhD project, and something that they maybe had, perhaps didn't learn during their in the master's thesis or a bachelor project. So what is the most important, do you think, skills that they can learn? Of course, this scientific writing is one of that, but beyond that, do you have some comments on that?
Okay, it's a very important question, of course. The whole PhD training, of course, is about to learn to think independently and critically, and that's a gradual process. When candidate starts, of course, everything is new. Then you are more in the asking and stage and mode. But then, at some time, and the earlier the better, you should just start questioning things and questioning your supervisor's opinions as well. So I think really the critical learning, critical thinking, and independence is the process.
But Anna, do you have any comments on this in your own background? Besides your deep technical knowledge, what are the kind of the life skill issues that you thought most important?
Yes, I think that the thing that I right away think of we that also that, or at least in environmental science and also in environmental field, a lot of information and different data is collected, and usually you are confronted with a lot of information when you do your doctoral thesis and you learn how to analyze and how to process that data, and that, my opinion, that is very useful skill in your work in everyday life, and that is really something that is not maybe used enough in our society, I think.
Okay. Do any other panelists want to comment on this? Okay. Any.
Eloranta, currently responsible for learning at this university. I'd like to build a bit on what Jorma Eloranta said at the start, so about this entrepreneurship stuff. In Europe, we've got the virtual technical university, EIT, And part of that is called ICT Labs, and it has got two programs at the moment, so master's program and doctoral program. And the point is that a compulsory part of doctoral program is formal education in entrepreneurship and innovation. So how would you punish, comment on that? Is it good or bad, and should we follow?
Who is the question addressed to? Okay, who would like to attack that question?
Well, I can say a little bit. I'm not sure I understood exactly the question, but my understanding of the question is that how should we approach teaching about entrepreneurship to doctoral students? Is that correct?
No. Normally at the universities, so business is business and research is business research, which means that at doctoral education, the formal studies are based on that fantastic theoretical thing that where the student will be a doctor one day. Okay, and this in these ICT labs, which is a joint effort between university and industries, there's a compulsory part of every doctor student there that they have to invest as part of their studies in business and innovation. And some of us professors like it, and some not. So, and I'd like to hear your comments on that.
Okay, thank you. So, well, you know, we like at Princeton also we have a good deal of instruction in entrepreneurship, and mostly through the engineering school, because we don't have a business school at Princeton. But it's not compulsory. And I think that might be a little bit too much. I mean, I understand that it's a very important part of, you know, job creation and getting new technologies into society, but not everyone is an entrepreneur. Some people are scholars, and that's perfectly fine, I think, for someone to be a scholar and not to be an entrepreneur. So my own feeling is that, you know, there are enough people who are very eager to be entrepreneurs that it's not necessary to require that. On the other hand, I think I don't think there's anything negative about doctoral students pursuing that kind of knowledge and ultimately pursuing, of course, entrepreneurial activities. It's a very legitimate way to make use of your doctoral education, as we heard today from the distinguished alumnus. So I think that's what I would say is requiring it seems to be maybe perhaps too strict, because not everyone has that spirit. This is my feeling.
Okay, I think Jorma first comment on this.
I said I am not a doctor, but I have learned that you need to think independently and critically. And I need to say that what I was a little bit worried in the panel discussion, namely about this schedule, how long time does it take to become a doctor, and I mean the period. And my feeling is that what is important in entrepreneurship is that you need to be at the same time creative, but also you need to have a discipline. You have to have a certain amount of money available, and you had to bring some value to the table with that money, and creative new utilizing new knowledge and new things. Unless you are able to do it, you are broke and you are done, and you can try to find a new project and so forth, but that project is end of the. So both and is the way of doing things in many fields of the leadership at this moment. And the target setting, therefore, discipline and creativeness at the same time is a fundamental learning which I hope everybody should have. And if the chairman allows, I can tell how I have learned that discipline.
Absolutely.
Okay, me and my wife, she's also graduated in the same in the department as me. We decided we don't marry before one of us is graduated. She graduated 73, and we married a couple of weeks after that. But then came my turn, and we also decided that we don't get the child before we both are graduated. And I just, not to go to details, but I started to do my diploma January 75. I got my diploma, or became the master's degree in the 2nd of June 75. And our daughter birthday was 15th of June there. So there was 13 days in between margin. So I learned a certain discipline, because I know, heard from my wife, that it is not possible to postpone the date.
Okay, now we've learned another good feature of being a CEO. So what I'll do is, we're actually getting very close, so I'm going to give first Anna, she wanted to make a comment, then I'll let Tuula make the final comment of this discussion. So Anna, would you care to say something?
There's actually something that I wanted to add to Jorma Eloranta's comment, that I have a background, actually, that the first or the second job that I got after my master's thesis was in a spin-off company from Aalto that started in 94. That was actually not a spin-off of a completely new innovation, but it was an application of a quite known technology worldwide that was just applied in Finnish conditions, and that created a company that worked very well. So I think that it's also important to know that it's you don't need to stress so much to be to have the greatest innovation of the world, but you can just do some, maybe take and reuse some of the old ideas also. I think that's completely acceptable as well. And also about the time that it takes to graduate, I started actually my thesis in 2002 and then worked half-time and tested more or less the research in full-scale plans during that time also, and I only see that as a huge benefit for everyone, so I would not like to have that strict rules either. I was also 4 times on maternity leave during that time, so it was also very interesting to use or learn some discipline also, when I knew that the baby is going to sleep only for 2 hours and I needed to finish the paper or at least one part of it during that time. So,
okay, I think Tuula, did you have a comment on this?
Yeah, I would like to maybe reflect on the question from Eloranta, that I think that, you know, we should in universities, we should kind of get rid of this thinking of uniformity, you know, that it, you know, when we talk about doctoral educations, you know, we now have actually at Aalto we have now 6 doctoral programs, you know, one for each school, you know, but I mean what you are describing from the EITI City Labs, you know, is a doctoral school, you know, with a different mission, you know, and this mission is, you know, to train doctors for entrepreneurial activities, and I don't think that these entrepreneurial activities that are kind of aimed for, you know, that they are only mean that, you know, starting new companies, but, you know, to have this kind of entrepreneurial mindset and thinking, and, you know, sort of elementary skills in business development, you know, understanding, you know, what does it actually mean? And we heard today, and I have exactly the same experience as our alumni of the year, that, you know, you make a discovery and you want to start a company and you have no clue of the basic concepts, you know, like balance sheet or profit and loss or even customer, you know, because you're so thrilled about your own technology that you don't understand that, you know, the customer needs to want it, you know. So I think it's a good idea, you know, to have these sort of directed doctoral programs. But of course, then, you know, when you apply, you know, when you seek for students for them, it has to be clear for them what the purpose of the doctoral education is, and it can't come at the expense of research quality. But I think that you can have these other kinds of. And I think it's useful, you know, I mean, it's useful for many. I mean, I think even, you know, we were talking about art, you know, and I think, you know, looking at the incredible possibilities in art and creative economy, as we talk about. We talk about creative economy, but it often ends up with the creative and the economy part is not actually completely realized, you know. So I think it's a good idea to give people some basic understanding of how to commercialize something, how to make something sellable. Thank you.
Okay, and with that word, I would like to express my personal thanks to all of our panelists. I feel like we could have gone on for another 3 or 4 hours, but we have to get ready for tomorrow, some of us. But thank you very much for doing this. And I hope the panelists can stay for the coffee and refreshments, and maybe some of the audience would still like to continue this discussion downstairs. And I welcome everyone in the audience. We have 25 exciting demonstrations, posters prepared by our graduate students. And please go and discuss with the researchers who you might be interested in. So thank you very much.